Changes are coming to the Commercial LEO Destinations program by NASA. If you're unfamiliar with this program, it aims to transition human presence in space from the International Space Station, that's due to be deorbited in 2030, to privately owned space stations, or LEO destinations, as NASA calls them. LEO means low Earth orbit. In the case of the International Space Station, the orbit is around 400 kilometers above the Earth. I have lots of thoughts about this change, since I've always considered the existing funding levels too low to realistically support viable commercial space stations. First, let's look at the NASA directive, followed by pushback from the former Deputy NASA Administrator, Pam Melroy, and then I'll give my thoughts. The directive. NASA's Acting Administrator, Sean Duffy, has issued a new directive on transitioning from the International Space Station to new commercial space stations. The directive states, the CLD, that's Commercial LEO Destinations Program, shall support commercial viability while enabling NASA's safe and sustainable transition from ISS operations, unquote. The directive goes on to say, with the plan to end operations and deorbit the International Space Station by 2030, the replacement must be more affordable for NASA. To avoid a gap in human presence in space, NASA needs to move quickly with the existing funds available. A change in approach is necessary to meet the schedule, proposed budget, and viability of commercial space stations. The CLD program consists of two phases. In phase one, NASA awarded a firm fixed-price contract to Axiom Space for designing modules that attach to the ISS before its retirement. At the same time, NASA signed funded Space Act agreements with several other companies, including Blue Origin and Starlab Space Consortium. It also entered into unfunded Space Act agreements with Sierra Space, SpaceX, Think Orbital, and Vast Space. The original Phase 2 proposal was to use the burdensome, inflexible, and difficult to follow Federal Acquisition Regulations, or FAR contracts. The revised Phase 2 proposal abandons FAR contracts in favor of continuing with funded Space Act agreements, which are more lightweight and easier for smaller companies and startups to comply with. Formal design acceptance and certification now occur at a later stage. NASA now grants industry maximum flexibility to design and develop space stations without its involvement. Companies are given 3 years to complete their tasks under the Space Act agreement, with the option to extend some milestones to 5 years. Any interested party may submit a proposal to NASA. An in-space demonstration with non-NASA crew is required, though the company is given the flexibility to decide which capabilities to demonstrate. As part of their end-to-end service offerings, companies can choose whether to include transportation to the space station. Other space agencies are free to make arrangements with the CLD providers during Phase 2 or follow-on phases. NASA plans to award at least two contracts, and preferably more, within 6 months of the request for proposals. At least 25% of the total payment hinges on a successful crewed demonstration mission. One key point is NASA now have the flexibility to award funding based on what industry is currently capable of achieving, rather than on what NASA would ideally want. This helps improve the viability of commercial space station operators. The awardees are expected to make cost realism assessments. In other words, don't deliberately underbid and then ask for more funds later. Full operational capability no longer binds awardees. Instead, NASA sets a new minimum capability of supporting 4 crew members for 1 month. This incidentally matches the mission profile for Vast Space Haven 1 module, scheduled to launch next year. This new minimum capability allows a minimum viable product station, as Vast Space terms it, the simplest space station that has value to NASA and to private astronauts. This is another big win for small contenders, such as Vast. In addition, NASA's LEO microgravity strategy, published by NASA during the previous administration, is no longer binding. This strategy required long-duration missions and sophisticated infrastructure such as robotic arms that would be difficult and costly for small space startups to finance. NASA must act swiftly, with 60 days to publish the Phase 2 request for proposals. The directive instructs NASA to ensure the Phase 2 architecture remains affordable with scalable designs that support a sustainable future for commercial stations. That covers the details. Let's now turn to the criticism of this approach, as outlined by Pam Melroy in her article on payload space. The article appears linked in the description, alongside details of the new directive to NASA. The pushback, Pam Melroy's opinion. Pam Melroy is a former space shuttle pilot and commander who helped build the International Space Station. She makes it clear in her article that she is appalled by the changes to NASA's CLD program. She believes it will result in NASA giving up a continuous human presence in space after the ISS is deorbited. She seems most upset about no requirement for long-duration flights and a crew of four staying for only 30 days at a time, resulting in gaps in human presence in space for the US. She believes these changes are harmful for the US capabilities in space and for future plans for Mars. She states that the medical community needs data from 100 6 to 9 month human missions in microgravity conditions to feel confident about sending humans to Mars. Without the long duration requirements for commercial stations, NASA will not have the necessary medical data to send humans to Mars. Large gaps between missions will be inevitable once NASA transitions to commercial stations because only a 30-day stay is mandated. Given the high cost of transportation, only 2 or 3 missions are likely per year without additional funding. She questions how much private capital will be raised for these private stations. She thinks China could become the partner of choice for other countries due to longer duration missions and more research opportunities. My thoughts on the new directive for commercial space stations. First, my thoughts on Pam Melroy's criticism. It's unclear where the 100 human missions needed by the medical community comes from. NASA's own documents suggest the use of modeling, ground analogs such as bed rest studies, and data collection to understand more about how microgravity affects the human body. Her claim that not enough long-duration missions have occurred also is open to question. Since 2000, the ISS has hosted over 70 expeditions, with crew rotations lasting longer than 6 months, involving more than 270 individuals in total. Some, such as Scott Kelly's, extended to nearly a year. With the ISS operating until 2030, even more data on long-duration missions will be added. She says that short stays in commercial stations will not help us get to Mars. There is no reason shorter missions will not yield valuable scientific data or allow for technical demos in microgravity. Her criticism undervalues how private actors can innovate, push down costs, helping to build a thriving low Earth orbit economy, where NASA is just one customer. State of play, likely contenders. The field is now open to any startup or company that would like to apply for Phase 2 funding under the Commercial LEO Destinations Program. Which companies are likely to bid? Vast Space. Vast Space emerges as a top contender with its Haven 1 module already built and currently undergoing validation ahead of launch on a Falcon 9 in May 2026. Its follow-on station, Haven 2, will likely form the design proposed to NASA. This larger station provides more space for research. Alternatively, VAST might choose to offer its Haven 1 module instead. Starlab Space. This is a consortium led by Voyager Space with companies from around the world. Airbus from Europe, Mitsubishi from Japan, and MDA Space from Canada. This station will be of particular interest to ESA and Europe because of the participation of Airbus. The directive states there is no problem with a contender having agreements and partnerships with other space agencies, which benefits Starlab. Axiom Space. Axiom, via Thales Alenia, has been building their modules for some time now. They've had to make design changes at the request of NASA already. Axiom Space is a key player for NASA because, in addition to their space station, they're working on Artemis spacesuit that's critical for crewed missions to the moon. NASA will likely prove eager to offer funding as the agency cannot afford for this company to fail. Orbital Reef. This is Blue Origin's project with support from other companies such as Sierra Space. Given the amount of work Blue Origin has at the moment with New Glenn, the Mark 1 and Mark 2 lunar landers, and their cislunar transporter vehicle, it's unclear how much time and resources they're spending on Orbital Reef. As NASA downscales its plan for commercial stations, Orbital Reef may appear oversized. Blue Origin might therefore simplify and reduce its scale, or perhaps choose not to bid at all. Starship. SpaceX did have an unfunded Space Act agreement to study using the Starship vehicle as a space station. With a new minimal requirement of 4 crew for 1 month, there is no reason SpaceX could not bid again. After all, Starship needs life support to take crews to Mars, so there is no additional cost required other than the paperwork to make a proposal to NASA. Final thoughts. NASA's previous commercial LEO destinations program lacked credibility due to a mismatch between available funding and the agency's requirements. Their full operating capability, which is no longer binding, demanded a gold-plated space station which would have been hugely expensive to build, validate, and certify. This would make any approved NASA space station uneconomical for private astronauts because the company would need to recoup the considerable costs of implementing all the capabilities NASA required. Thankfully, those requirements no longer apply and are replaced with 1 month missions for 4 crew members, which can be satisfied with smaller, simpler, and cheaper space stations. This is the right decision and makes it more likely commercial space stations will be able to attract business from private individuals and perhaps companies looking to do microgravity research for pharmaceuticals or material science. Industry figures, such as VAST chief executive, have noted that these adjustments enable a minimal viable product strategy, which is less capital intensive and better suited to resource-constrained space startups. Overall, these changes acknowledge the industry's limited capital for meeting NASA's requirements and, as a result, prioritize smaller, simpler, and cheaper stations through lightweight contracts to accelerate progress and improve the prospects of commercially viable stations emerging. Okay, those are my thoughts. What do you think? Do you agree with Pam Melroy that giving up continuous human presence in space is bad and will harm plans to go to Mars? Or do you think it will help bring about a thriving private business and tourism in low Earth orbit? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with late-breaking space news and previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.